Our school, the School of Human and Health Sciences, is the largest in the university. Perhaps unsurprisingly, we deliver education and we do research in several areas relating particularly to health and social care, and that includes nursing. The research obviously includes also research that's relevant in the context of palliative and end-of-life care. And we're really proud to be hosting this event delivered in partnership with NHS England. As you might already know, we've been working in partnership with the NHS to deliver a suite of regular research-led webinars. After each webinar, we ask attendees what research topics they'd like to hear more about in future webinars, and palliative and end-of-life care nursing was a really frequent suggestion, hence the event today. Today, we're joined by four excellent speakers who are leading names in their field. They'll be presenting their research and discussing their experiences of conductive palliative and end-of-life research. First, Catherine Walsh, who's a professor of palliative care at the International Observatory on End-of-Life Care at Lancaster University and editor-in-chief of Palliative Medicine, will examine the provision of palliative care and the impact of nursing multidisciplinary teams and the wider community. Second, Sue Latter, who's a professor of health services research, and Natasha Campling, who's a lecturer and senior research fellow at the School of Health Sciences at the University of Southampton, we're delivering a joint presentation on evaluating access to medicines at the end of life. And finally, Catherine Evans is a professor of palliative care and honorary nurse consultant at King's College London and Sussex Community NHS Foundation Trust. Catherine will be speaking about integrating palliative care into community healthcare for older adults and multiple morbidity. We won't be breaking between speakers, but we will be bringing them all back together after the talks to discuss the issues raised by the research. I encourage you please to pose questions or make comments using the quick Q&A function, which is at the bottom of your screen. But before we hear from our speakers, I'm really delighted to welcome Professor Mark Radford, who's a Deputy Chief Nursing Officer for NHS England and Chief Nurse and Deputy CEO at Health Education England, who would like to make a few opening remarks. Over to you, Mark.
Nick, thank you so much for that kind introduction, and welcome, colleagues, to a further in our series of really important webinars that we've been running with the great team at the University of Huddersfield. Today is a really important session, and as Nick rightly pointed out, we have got some fantastic speakers and an opportunity for debate and discussion through this, looking at the lens of research and research opportunities that nursing can bring to understanding complex clinical problems for service users, patients and families. And today our focus is very much looking at the opportunities for the development of research evidence in supporting clinical practice, professional practice and service delivery within advancing palliative care and end-of-life support. This is a vital area of research and one that I know has a very strong tradition of collaborative research opportunities across all of the multi-professional teams that work in end-of-life and palliative care. But really, it's important to stress that each and every one of those professionals brings a unique lens and contribution to the care of patients and families during this period. And research that focus in on not only how do we deliver better for our patients, but also importantly, how professionals work together, have always been a feature of the research environment in this space. But nursing provides a unique contribution to palliative and end-of-life care. And today's seminar really provides us with a great deal of opportunity through phenomenal research contributors to explore this in great detail, as well as also have debate later on. One of the reasons that this is really important is, of course, is recognising the phenomenal contribution that our universities and research active nurses contribute up and down the country to furthering and advancing our knowledge in relation to clinical practice. It is really important that this links through to the launch of the Chief Nursing Officer's research strategy last November, which fundamentally focused on how do we bring together the nursing, both clinical policy and research community, to further advance the opportunities to deliver better outcomes for our patients and our populations, but also build upon the phenomenal expertise that already exists in many of our institutions up and down the country, and to further embed evidence-based practice in how we deliver services. I'm absolutely delighted that the University of Huddersfield team have been able to put on this event. We've got hundreds of colleagues joining us from around the globe, which I think is going to be a really exciting agenda today. Supportive from Health Education England and NHS England, and delighted that we'll have a chance to debate and discuss a little bit later on during the panel. So without further ado, I'm going to hand back to Nick to introduce the great speakers that we've got for this session today. And Nick, back to you, sir.
Thanks so much, Mark. A great kind of context to the presentations that we're going to hear, talking about particularly about the unique lens and contribution of nurses, but also how professionals work together, and also thinking about the contribution of nurses to research, which we're going to see some of right now. So let's move on with the reason that everybody's here. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Professor Catherine Walsh, and I'll see you all in a little while.
Thank you very much for that very kind introduction. So I'm going to be talking today about a number of different research studies. So I've chosen to focus briefly on four studies that I've been involved with, hopefully bringing some of that nursing lens that we've been talking about to that. I am a nurse. I'm very proud to be a nurse, and my clinical background informs my current role as a researcher in palliative care. And this is me at the end of my very first lot of night duty, which is why we're all looking a little bit stunned. And if you're not sure which is me, it's the one that's circled there, right at the end of my first year as a nursing student. And whilst that might be rather a long time ago now, the experiences that I've had from then on as a nurse bring a lens to the work that I do, which I think is really important. I've chosen, first of all, to briefly mention some research that I did for my PhD. And I think it's fair to say that registering for a PhD in my mid-30s, not uncommon for a nurse, was really the springboard to my career as a nurse who was leading research. So you can see from this here, it wasn't focused on nursing per se, but as with all of my research, it was informed by my nursing experiences. In this instance, I was exploring what influenced referrals of patients with palliative care needs across and between community palliative care services. I'm not really going to talk about methods, but in this case, we used a qualitative case study approach in incorporating, and that's the key thing, a range of different perspectives. So I spoke to generalists like district nurses and GPs. I spoke to specialist palliative care providers. I spoke to nurses, patients, managers, commissioners, you name it, I spoke to them. So I'm going to focus on the two main issues that appear to affect referrals. First, people's perceptions of their own role, whatever that role might be. They saw themselves as autonomous professionals making independent judgments about referrals, influenced by their own expertise, their workload, and what they saw as the really special nature of providing palliative care, whatever their role. They talked a lot about the relationships that they developed with patients. And actually, that had an influence because there was a sense of ownership, perhaps, of those patients, or certainly a sense of concern about letting go to others. Second, their perception about the others to whom they refer. They reported to really need to know about the services that they referred to. And they made a really complex judgment about the professionals involved. They knew that those relationships with the other professionals were important and needed to endure as well beyond the care of an individual patient. So I guess the key point I want to make here is that there are many, many more factors than just the assessment of the patient's clinical need. In fact, that was possibly one of the least important things. So the complexity, yes, clearly these were complex patients, but the complexity was about that personal, interpersonal and interprofessional factors that shaped those referral practices. And I think we as nurses and other practitioners need to be much more explicit about those influences on decision making, because actually just writing referral criteria, for example, ain't going to make a difference. And policymakers need to really take account of those complex influences, not just mandating change. Next, I'm going to talk about a study because it was specifically a nurse study. Here, I focused on what nurses were doing, in this instance, district nursing, which is, I've had a, what do they call it? A long portfolio career, but spent many years as a district nurse working out in the community. And I think as a researcher, I wanted to explore more about what nurses were actually doing when they provided care, and which often we'd call invisible. And here, the ethnographic nature of this study meant that I observed encounters and then interviewed patients and nurses after those encounters. In the interview data, the nurses spoke a lot about how they developed relationships with patients to enable future care. Clearly, really important. But when I actually observed the care, much of it actually focused on physical symptom management. Now, I'm not being negative about that. The care was effective and hugely appreciated by patients and family carers. But I think it illuminated the difference between what we do and what we might hope that we do, and the need to really appreciate the range of skills and their impact, and to be proud of those skills and own them, because they were very important to people. Next on my muscle stop tour, I'm going to talk about a study that I led, which focused much more on those wider ways that support and care are provided. And in this instance, focused on the role of volunteers in providing palliative care as part of a wider team that certainly involved nurses and nursing care as well, who were providing care at home to many of these people who were being supported by the volunteers. This was in the context of a randomized control trial, just to broaden the scope of some of the methods that we might want to talk about, with again some nested qualitative case study research. So again, what did we find? We found that those patients who received a care from a volunteer had a reduction in the rate of decline of quality of life. Now, this is actually quite important. If all we'd done was study people who had a volunteer, all we would have seen was a reduction in quality of life. And you might say, oh, that's not great. they're not having an impact. But because in the trial, we were comparing that to people who were waiting to have the service, who didn't yet have it, we could see that they were having an impact on quality of life. It was declining less rapidly. And when the patients talked about why the volunteers were important, this is a really key quote. It comes from the heart. A comment from the patients that part of the impact of volunteers was because the volunteers didn't have to do it. They weren't being paid to care. They were doing it because they wanted to. And that made the patients feel very valued and very special in a way that perhaps I have never managed with my nursing hat on. So it certainly had impacts on well-being, with people describing feeling less lonely, isolated, depressed, or anxious, and really shows some of the importance of the role of volunteers as part of that wider healthcare team. There's a lot of emphasis at the moment on public health palliative care and compassionate communities. And as nurses, we should never forget that we are part of that wider team and recognise and value the role of those wider team members. The final study I'm going to draw from in this whistle-stop tour of different studies is actually something that's clearly very contemporary. And this is part of the COVPAL study that was funded to explore the role of specialist palliative care in this instance during the most of these data that I'm going to talk to you about were in the second wave of COVID. This is part of a much larger study. We did a survey and we also collected routine data on patients who were being cared for with COVID-19. But one of the studies we did was a multiple qualitative case study again, really digging into what it was like to provide specialist palliative care, in this instance, based within hospice settings. Remembering, of course, that nursing is so much more than the NHS. And in this instance, we drew from a number of different hospices across England. Again, my main focus is going to be on the findings. And what I particularly want to emphasise today, and if you read the paper, there's clearly much more than this, was the experience of moral distress. For those of you providing care now and throughout the COVID-19 pandemic, I guess this won't come as a surprise to you. But what we felt we were doing was giving a voice to those people who were providing care in the thick of it. And a particular feature that was really challenging was about the visiting policies that forced people to make decisions and operate in ways that were opposite to the person-centered values that they held. So it was about saying, you can't come in, and witnessing people dying without their families or loved ones present was a real distressing conflict that people experienced. They talked about the moral injuries that they suffered, exemplifying the enduring psychological, emotional, and physical harms of repeated exposure to moral distress, which will have continued beyond this data collection. But there were positive things to say as well, that they spoke about how they experienced comfort in their situation, as they were felt they were making a valued contribution to the pandemic response. And many of those that talked about that were nurses, were part of the nursing care team providing care. So I'm going to finish there, but loop back. I think the naive 18-year-old me back in the 1980s thought that being a nurse was going to be like this. And actually, of course, through my career, I have actually discovered that a real love for nursing research and for nurse-led research and research in general. So I fixed it. So become a nurse researcher. Hey, you could even do a PhD. Great opportunities for everyone in any care settings. So I hope that's whetted your appetite a little bit for some of the talks that are following me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Catherine. It's interesting, I mentioned, for the benefit of the audience, I did get a glimpse of the photo, the training photo, Catherine's training photo, and I'm not sure whether you can kind of roughly age people according to the style of photo that they have, or particularly the style of dress and hair that happens at that time. But thank you for that, and thanks for the questions. And please, if you've got any questions for Catherine, please do put them in the Q&A. Specific questions. I know it has provoked some questions in me. I'm going to now move on and hand over to Sue Latter and Natasha Campling, who are going to do a joint presentation. Thank you. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Nick, and good afternoon, everybody. It's great to have an opportunity to talk to you this afternoon. We're going to do something slightly different. Natasha and I are sharing a presentation about a study that we led as nurses at the University of Southampton School of Health Sciences. And our aim today in this short slot is to just highlight some of the issues it raised that may be relevant to you as nurses or other healthcare professionals listening today, and have a think about how those issues, if they were addressed, would contribute to advancing palliative and end-of-life care. So the study is called the ACMED study, or Access to Medicines at End of Life. And next slide, please. It was a collaboration of three universities. So it was led from the University of Southampton, and we worked with the University of Leeds and the University of Bradford. And as all good research studies are these days, it was a multidisciplinary team of different healthcare professionals. So we had consultant, specialist palliative care doctor, GP, pharmacist, health economist, statistician, patient and public involvement. But important to say, I think, that the team was led by nurses, by Natasha and I at Southampton. Next slide, please. Just to acknowledge that the study was funded by the National Institute for Health Research, and what we're going to say today are our views and not those of the NIHR or the Department of Health and Social Care. Next slide, please. So how did this study come about? So the context was came from a number of different directions. We previously had some funding, again, from the National Institute for Health Research, to look at helping patients self-manage medicines in the last 12 months of life. And whilst we were running that study, we noticed a signal or a suggestion from some of our interviews that actually the whole process of obtaining medicines, and when you're caring for someone at home, managing symptoms at home, we had signals that actually this might be quite difficult for people. So we pricked our ears and thought, actually, also knowing as clinicians that we hear stories about this, we thought perhaps this warrants further detailed investigation. We also knew from the wider literature that often patients and carers, when they're managing medicines at home, often their needs for information about those medicines and their support needs are quite often unmet. So we've got Sheila Payne's team again, and Eleanor Wilson at Nottingham done some work in that area and suggested that actually that's also something that needs further investigation. We know too that accessing medicines out of hours can be difficult. And we know from international studies, Kuribilla et al. In Australia, Williams et al. Did a large study, team at Cardiff. They looked through the National Reporting and Learning System database, looking at patient safety incidents out of hours in community palliative care. And what they found were that over half of the incidents were actually medication related. Again, contributing to this picture that timely access, timely advice, inefficient communication are often there in the mix. And we wanted to understand more about this, but particularly in the context of, we know that there are different ways of delivering palliative care across the country, more or less specialist care. We know that there are also innovations in service delivery. So for example, we know that more pharmacists prescribe these days, more nurses do. We know that there are telephone support lines for palliative care patients. But again, we didn't really know whether any of these new models emerging, or the traditional models even, how they influence the experience of accessing medicines. Next slide, thank you. So the aim of our study was quite simply to provide an evaluation of patients and carers' access to medicines at the end of life. And by that, we meant within the last 12 months of life and not at the very end of life. And we wanted to look at that experience within the context of different models of service delivery. And I should say that we defined access as patients or a carer's ability to obtain medicines from a prescriber and a dispenser, together with any information and skills about medicines that they receive at that point. Next slide, please. So it's a large study, and I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about the methods, but there will be references that follow where you could read more about this particular study. Five phases to the study, but we're just going to focus today on a few highlights from the questionnaire survey that we conducted, and Natasha's going to talk a little bit about the case studies. So starting with the survey, we did an online survey. What we wanted to do was to understand how currently healthcare professionals, a range of healthcare professionals, are actually providing support for accessing medicines in the community. And what are the factors that both challenge them in fulfilling that role and what are the factors that support them in that role. And you can see there that we had a healthy response, 500 GPs nearly, almost 400 clinical nurse specialists, 199 community nurses, and around about 350 community or practice-based pharmacists. Thank you. Next slide, please. So just going to share a few key issues that came out today. Again, this has been written up as a paper if any of you do want to read more detail. But we asked, first of all, what are you currently doing? How are you providing support for patients to obtain new prescriptions during working hours, and how do you do that? And in short, and we were pleased about this, but all healthcare professional groups, pharmacists, nurses, specialists, generalists, were involved in this process, and that's consistent with NICE guidance that says that all health professionals should be involved in supporting patients in the last 12 months of life. We noted then, and this was pre-pandemic, that they were also using a variety of methods to ensure that patients access medicines at home. So they were using home visits, as well as telephone consultations, email consultations, GP practice appointments, and so on. However, we started to get a signal at this stage, which was confirmed in our case studies, that actually the GPs remained a predominant route for patients to access new prescriptions. So across all of the professional groups involved in the survey, over 93% of them were using referral to a GP as a route for patients to obtain new medicines. But just to highlight how we are moving to a multi-professional prescribing workforce, large proportions of our different professional groups also reported that they were referring to a nurse prescriber for patients to obtain new prescriptions. So, for example, 78% of our community nurse sample said that they were referring to nurse prescribers, and 65% of GPs also said that. Next slide, please. A couple of key issues we just want to flag for you, which you may find of interest. So we asked the nurses in our sample whether they had the full independent prescriber qualification, the B300 qualification. And you can see there that 42% of our clinical nurse specialists were trained as independent prescribers, and 27% of the community nurses, the general community nurses in our sample, also had that qualification. We might debate whether you think that's a healthy number or not. Our argument was that actually we think there should be more nurse prescribers in the workforce. But also, quite surprisingly there, or maybe not surprising to you, we asked them, the nurses who were trained as prescribers, whether they had access to the electronic prescribing system. And you can see there that very low numbers, clinical nurse specialists, only 6% of those who were trained as prescribers were able to access electronic prescribing. Rather more of community nurses, but still just over a third only were able to access electronic prescribing systems. And Natasha will talk to you a bit more about how that influenced prescribing in practice. Next slide, please. Another key issue to flag to you that came up in the survey was this thing about accessing shared records. Now, you'll know as practicing clinicians that being able to access a record before you prescribe is pretty important to check patients' medical history, to check their drug history, in order to safely and swiftly prescribe. So it was a key issue that we wanted to investigate. And whilst there were relatively high levels of ability to share across records between general practice, GP out-of-hours services, and community nurses, the clinical nurse specialist in particular, again in our study, reported pretty limited access to other professionals' records. Community pharmacists too, this is the way that regulation operates at the moment, but their access was largely confined to the summary care record, which doesn't contain any details of the patient's medical or drug history. So perhaps unsurprisingly, when we asked how satisfied our different professional groups were with the access they had to shared records, their satisfaction was quite low. So I'm saying there at the bottom of the slide, 39% of all professional groups, across all professional groups in our survey, were either only slightly or not at all satisfied with the access that they had to shared records that would support access to medicines. Next slide, please. And my final slide here on the survey, we asked all of our respondents at the end of the questionnaire, what did they think were the most important service delivery solutions that would help patients to access medicines. And you can see that the four top solutions were improved community pharmacy provision of palliative care medicines, more nurse and pharmacist prescribers in the mix, shared electronic records, and more better integrated healthcare professional working. I'm going to hand over to Natasha now.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to move on to talk about the case studies that we conducted in the third phase of the ActMed study. These involved in-depth evaluations of medicines access experiences. So in each case, up to 10 patients plus their carers were recruited. They completed logs on their medicines access experiences on a weekly basis, which formed aid memoirs to dyad interviews conducted on study entry and at weeks 4 and 8. We extracted data on medicines prescribed and healthcare service resource use to enable economic analysis across the different cases, and that was from 40 patient records in each case. And we also conducted up to 30 healthcare professionals interviews in each case, and those were with healthcare professionals who were providing end-of-life care in the cases. So the unit of analysis for each case was a distinct model of service delivery. The first was where the patients accessed medicines via GP prescribing. The second was where patients had a palliative care clinical nurse specialist who was a prescriber. And the third one was where patients had access to a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week palliative care telephone support line. So across all cases, accessing medicines wasn't a straightforward process, but one that tended to involve a complex set of activities from getting prescriptions, both new and repeat ones, to liaising with community pharmacies and practice dispensaries. And indeed, for some patients and their families, this was at times liaising with hospital pharmacies and private healthcare systems. And that was right through also in the process to arranging for collections and deliveries. I think the data demonstrated empirically for the first time that for some patients and carers, this was a really complex process, which was burdensome and confusing to them. We had hints, as Sue mentioned earlier, from the existing literature that this might be the case, but our data demonstrated this empirically. And additionally, the data demonstrates that there were high levels of coordination work that were being undertaken by healthcare professionals. And some of these models were operating much better than others to support timely access to medicines. So central to this was professional coordination, where a key healthcare professional took responsibility for leading the coordination of medicines access, the patient experience was better. The work for patients and carers was seen as less burdensome and difficult. Medicines were accessed faster and with fewer hurdles or delays. In our data, this lead coordination role was happening less often in the GP prescribing case, where patients and carers often needed to undertake this work themselves, whereas more of this work was taken on by other healthcare professionals in the other cases. So CNS prescribers eased medicines access with fewer barriers and or delays because they took a lead role as a point of contact and systems coordinator. It was their specialist prescriber knowledge of medicines and services that led to preemptive obstacle removal or immediate problem solving. In contrast, in the GP prescriber model, where there was, of course, also prescriber authority, specialist palliative and end-of-life care knowledge and knowledge of local services was often lacking, as our survey had also demonstrated. Patient and carer access to medicines was also shaped by healthcare professional access to shared records and electronic prescribing systems. In the telephone support line case, medicines access was facilitated via comprehensive shared access to records across the service. In the CNS prescriber case, their ability to facilitate medicines access was hampered by lack of access to shared records and no access to electronic prescribing systems. And indeed, it was this lack of access to electronic prescribing systems which influenced when the clinical nurse specialist chose to prescribe. This occurred when it would be faster than waiting for a GP script. So this was often where there were limitations in nominated pharmacy stocks or where GPs were difficult to access, such as late in the day. And that's my very brief summary of the case studies. And I'm now going to hand back to Sue to conclude. Sue, you're on mute.
Unmuting. So that's a whistle-stop tour through the study, but we just to point out some of the key conclusions that we highlighted at the end of our report. How do we advance palliative and end-of-life care, in particular with respect to accessing medicines? So we're arguing that greater numbers of nurses must be trained and supported to prescribe in this context, that we need to move away from a model where GPs are the main route through which all prescription requests are channeled. These are related, but we also think that there needs to be perhaps a named healthcare professional coordinator role, which would be helpful not only for the multidisciplinary team of healthcare professionals providing medicines, but also for the patient and carer. That must go together with shared access or better shared access to patient records across the different healthcare professional groups involved. And we haven't talked much about it today, but another key feature of our study was the reliability or not of community pharmacy stock of palliative care medicines. And we argued that that needs to be more reliable and it needs to be more evenly distributed. And then we'll end it and we look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. There are some questions have popped up into the Q&A, so please keep those questions coming. We, as I mentioned at the start, we're going to be reserving the questions until the end, when all of the speakers will come back as a panel to address the questions. Thank you very much for raising some really interesting kind of practical and perhaps cultural problems as well. So I'll now hand over to Catherine Evans, our final speaker. Catherine.
Thank you very much, Nick. I'm just going to share my slide with everybody. There you go. I hope everyone can see that. Okay, so thank you very much. What fascinating presentations from Catherine and Sue and Natasha. So I'm going to speak a little bit now about my programme of work on integrating palliative care into community healthcare for older adults. And I'm actually going to focus specifically on adults with dementia. The reason for doing that is that the need for palliative care is great and rising. The picture that you can see on the left-hand side was the announcement in the BBC News back in 2016, when dementia became the main cause of death in England. And it has continued to be the main cause of death in England. So it's not only is the need great now, but the need is also rising. So the graph on the right depicts the increase in people living and dying with dementia. So we estimate that by 2040, there'll be a four-fold increase in the projected rise of people dying with dementia. So that's projected as over 200,000 individuals annually in England by 2040. And when we think about dementia, we need to remember it primarily affects older adults, most of whom will live with multiple conditions. That dementia is a degenerative disease, that everybody with a diagnosis of dementia will die with that diagnosis. It is a disease that as it progresses, the patient experiences increasing distressing symptoms and concerns, and there is increasing demand on their carers. But even though we know all these things about dementia, the provision of palliative and end-of-life care is often very late in the disease trajectory, often not recognised until the person is in the dying phase. So I'm going to present to you a programme of work that I lead around dementia palliative care. And I'm going to present this very much drawing on a great quote from Van Gogh. And he, in describing his own career, said, as an artist, one is merely a link in a chain. And I would argue that as a nurse scientist or a nurse researcher or a clinical academic, one is a vital link in a chain. And as I give this presentation, I want to very much demonstrate the multiple and diverse links that as nurses leading research, that the individuals that we work with to enable us to conduct the high caliber research that makes a difference in patient care. So the program of work I'm going to just briefly introduce you to is called Embed Care. And that means empowering better end of life dementia care. So over on the left-hand side, I co-lead this program of work with my colleague, Professor Liz Sampson from UCL. And what this program of work enabled us to do was to bring together the specialties of dementia care and palliative care, very much in feeling that that was the way that we could really make a difference and leverage change in improving the provision of palliative care to this patient group. And when you look at this table, you can see the many different individuals, the many different links that are involved in this program of work. So you can see the methodologists, the health economists, the implementation scientists. And also, maybe most importantly, over on the right-hand side are PhD students. So a huge part of this program of work is around building research capacity in palliative dementia care. And the photograph on the right-hand side is when we first got together as a group and we had a fabulous day brainstorming as we began, as we wrote the initial outline for this program of research. So what does Embed Care aim to do? So broadly, it has four main aims. Our main and overarching intention is to lever a step change in palliative dementia care by generating new knowledge and a network for care, engagement, and research. We're working to co-design and evaluate the Embed Care framework, our intervention that we've developed from the program, that seeks to empower people with dementia, their carers and staff, by identifying and acting upon changing needs across community settings, for both for adults living at home and those within care homes. And as I said, a key part of the programme is to build research capacity in dementia care and specifically in palliative dementia care. And an essential component of our programme is, of course, the way we work collaboratively with our patient and public involvement members, all of whom are individuals affected by dementia, either that they live with dementia, they're a current carer of a person with dementia, or they're a bereaved carer of a person with dementia. And the photograph on the left-hand side is, of course, I'm sure we all have now, is a photograph of one of our many Zoom meetings with our public members across the programme. So when we think about, well, what does this programme actually involve? So what this figure illustrates gives an overview of the programme. And as you can see, it's really quite extensive. It involves six different work packages. So the work packages at the bottom, very much building that new knowledge and then moving up to intervention development and evaluation. And then importantly, on either side are the two pillars that very much run throughout the programme. So as I've just said, the patient and public involvement, and of course, the public and policy engagement to ensure that we can lever that change and we're thinking about that throughout the entire programme. So for this presentation, I'm just going to focus on two areas. The work stream one, which is very much in developing the conceptual model of integrated palliative care. And then work stream six in actually then co-designing how could we actually apply that conceptual model in clinical practice and how could we evaluate it to see if it actually made a difference for patients and families. So firstly, this is a very busy figure depicting work stream one. So work stream one used a method of meta review, meaning that we conducted a review of reviews to develop a system-based logic model of integrated palliative dementia care. What we were seeking to do is to build a conceptual understanding of what are the essential components of palliative care for people with dementia. And what this logic model depicts is that you can see areas that are have a star on them or an asterisk are components of care that were identified in five or more of the systematic reviews that we included within this work. And you can see that there are several areas where we clearly have very strong evidence around what essential palliative care could look like for people with dementia care. But the red areas are the areas where there was no or limited evidence. So, for example, around culturally competent care, we have very little evidence that actually informs, well, what does culturally competent palliative dementia care actually look like? So those areas of uncertainties were the areas that we have pursued across the programme. And when you look at this figure, you can see at the top the intervention theory. So this is very much how does the intervention work? And you can see, not surprisingly, some key components of about this way of delivering care needs to be person-centred, but that also needs to be linked with relational care to uphold the sense of self as people living with dementia experience cognitive decline. An emphasis very much on promoting well-being, but also with function, including spirituality, independence, and maintaining cognition. And then over on the far right, you can see the many health outcomes that we identified from the systematic reviews. And I should say that we included 33 systematic reviews. So it gives a sense this is a huge body of evidence. And we brought together systematic reviews that were concerning the provision of palliative care for adults with dementia in their last 1 or 2 years of life, with the intention that that service delivery intervention was seeking to improve the quality of life for the person living with dementia. So most of those outcomes focused very much on quality of life or well-being for the person, neuropsychiatric symptoms. But what was very missing from those outcomes was that there had been far less consideration of physical symptoms, for example, like pain and comfort and breathlessness, things like reducing falls, and no review considered spirituality. The other important red area on those outcomes is that also none of the reviews considered economic evaluation. Nine of them used meta-analysis, so we were able to map the outcomes where we could see benefit and the components of care that were making a difference. And that very much centered around person-centered care, holistic assessment, and the training of staff. The bit in the middle on the intervention design describes the what of the intervention. And again, one of the key components of that is the notion of a supportive environment. And interestingly, all the evidence around a supportive environment came from the systematic reviews, very much from dementia care that we examined through our palliative care lens. And it's a nice example of how essential it is to bring together two different evidence bases from two different disciplines and the difference that can make in constructing this type of conceptual understanding. So what did we then do? We have this really quite detailed and complex conceptual understanding as to how we think integrated palliative dementia care may work and what is needed and what are the essential components. But of course, we really needed to think through, well, how can we actually apply this in the real world? What needs to happen for practitioners to be able to work in this way in clinical practice? So I'm whizzing us all the way through now on this programme to Workstream 5. So this is the work where we were co-designing what we called our embed care framework and developing it as an app, as an e-health intervention. And this is work led by my colleagues Nathan Davis and Claire Ellis-Smith. And the lovely photograph that you're looking at in this slide is our latest co-design workshop that was conducted just last week. And this was very exciting for us. This was the first opportunity that we'd actually been able to bring together our clinical colleagues and our social care colleagues who we are working with on this program. So co-designing the embed care framework and app. So what the embed care framework comprises of is something called the Integrated Palliative Care Outcome Scale for Dementia, IPOS-DEM for short. And the intention of using that is to enhance processes of holistic assessment, to identify and assess the needs and concerns, both for the person living with dementia and their family carers. But importantly, that outcome measure is then linked with clinical decision support tools called rules of thumb. And then wrapped around that are the training and support activities for practitioners in care homes, in community nursing teams, to be able to use the embed care framework in their clinical care. So the way that we sought to develop this is that we've been going through a process of iterative co-designs. And all from the last year, those have all been conducted virtually. And as I said, this was very exciting to be able to bring clinical colleagues together and work together in person. And the little Atonics at the bottom is the tech company who we have been working with to develop our embed care framework to be delivered as an app on tablets and smartphones by our clinical colleagues. So I'm just going to give a little bit of an introduction as to what exactly is IPOS-DEM. So this is just a snapshot of this outcome measure. And our intention within the embed care framework is very much to use assessment as an intervention. And what's important and helpful about IPOS-DEM is its intention is to support person-centered care. And remembering on our conceptual model, it was person-centered care that is actually a key underpinning concept within the intervention. And IPOS-DEM seeks to be person-centered. As you can see over on the left, it begins by asking about what is the person's main problems over the past week. So either asking the person with dementia if they have capacity to be able to articulate what their problems are, or proxy reported by a family member or staff. And then over on the right-hand side, you can see that IPOS-DEM then asks individuals about how they are affected by different symptoms and concerns. So it doesn't ask how much they've got, it asks how they are affected. And as you look down the symptoms and concerns, you can see that this is very much holistic in encompassing the different domains of health, for example, of pain, for example, of anxiety and depression. And if you'd like to know more about this, it's built very much on the POS family of measures that you can find out more from in the web link there on the slide. So our understanding of using assessment as an intervention is something that is not new in using outcome measures in this way, but it's something that's not really been used and implemented within palliative dementia care. And the reason for doing that is some earlier work that we had done that was led by a colleague, Julie Kinley, who is a nurse consultant and had opportunity for an internship with us at the Cicely Saunders Institute. And what these radar plots are showing is, well, this is what an IPOS-DEM score looks like. So the blue lines is the score at somebody's baseline. So, for example, when they are first referred to a service. And then the pinky line in the middle is showing how those areas of symptoms and concerns have improved or not over time. And you can see when you look round the radar plots, the different areas that are assessed within IPOS-DEM. So again, seeing the physical concerns and then on the right-hand side, the psychosocial concerns. But of course, if we identify and assess unmet symptoms and needs, what we then also need to do is to be able to support practitioners and family members to actually manage those unstable symptoms and concerns. So also part of our co-design work was in developing clinical decision support tools that are sometimes called rules of thumb. And this is work led by Nathan Davis. So through the co-design work, we identified 12 key decision areas and then developed rules of thumbs for each of those. And what a rule of thumb means is that it's a way of presenting something very complex in terms of assessment, treatment, and the intended outcomes in something that's accessible for practitioners to use in day-to-day clinical practice. And you can see within these 12 decision areas, again, the breadth of different areas that we have developed decision support tools for practitioners to use in their clinical care. And again, the breadth of things from the emotional well-being of the person right through to spirituality. And as I said, in our initial systematic review, we didn't identify any system level interventions that had considered spirituality. And this is just to give you a taste of what a rule of thumb looks like. So this is one on pain. So on our Embed Care app, this is presented to practitioners. If, for example, on the IPOS-DEM, the practitioner assesses that the person's level of pain is severe or above, it then takes them to the relevant rule of thumb to support their clinical decision making. And you can see that this is then split up in an accessible way of assessment. How do they assess? What might be the causes of pain for them to consider? What are the things around treatment, both non-pharmacological and pharmacological interventions? We then also present this inner flow diagram for practitioners as well, and then their ability to click onto links to actually see the resources that underpin this information. And as I said, this is very much about enabling practitioners to deliver evidence-based care at the point of care. And then finally, within the co-design work, one of the key things is always about considering implementation from the start. So these types of complex interventions, absolutely vital that we think from the get-go how actually a practitioner is going to use this in clinical care. And this is work that's been led by two of my PhD students, so Tufunmi Arundu and Juliet Gillam. And the publications underneath are their systematic review work that very much is developing the conceptual understanding around implementation. So Tufumi's work focusing very much on using the Embed Care framework to support shared decision-making for adults living with dementia at home. And Juliet's work very much in developing an implementation plan for the Embed Care framework as an e-health intervention to be used within care homes. So very innovative and novel work. And then finally, Workstream 6. So this is now, hopefully in the autumn, in November, we are looking to open with our clinical teams in Derbyshire and Sussex to then be able to actually examine, well, is it feasible for practitioners to use the Embed Care framework in their clinical practice and to use it by delivering it within an app, an e-health intervention? And quite typically for a feasibility evaluation, this used mixed methods. We then move on to a pilot clusterized randomized trial to understand more the methods of evaluation. And our intention within this work is very much to test the Embed Care framework and app, being very attentive to the implementation requirements to inform wider rollout. And also that it's very much theory driven to actually understand, well, how does this very complex intervention in the Embed Care framework actually work? And what do practitioners need to be able to use it in their clinical care? And then finally, just to say thank you for listening, and that if you are interested in palliative care for people with dementia, then please do email us. We have a network for excellence in palliative dementia care, which we would very much welcome individuals to be part of. And please do also look at our webpage, which details all the various references and gives much more information about the wider programme. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Catherine. That was really interesting. I found radar plots really useful in terms of visualisation, particularly for comparisons, of course. Thank you. Could I invite all of the panellists to now step back into the room, please, and we'll work our way through some of the questions. I'm not sure that we're going to get through around to all of the questions. Thank you for posing the questions, but I'm sure that the panelists would be willing for you to pick it up, Google them. They're all famous. Google them and you'll find them and send your questions through to them. I'm going to kind of work, I think, in reverse order. What I think we'll do is... if I pose a question and then I'll throw it open to the panel as well if other people want to comment on the question, but I'll target questions to individuals largely based on the presentations. But also I'm going to try to cover some of the questions that came through the Q&A and also questions that were delivered to us as part of the registration. And Mark Radford, of course, is joining us as well, and he may have one or two things to say there. I was quite interested, Catherine, and this has cropped up in some of the questions aspects of it, I guess. You mentioned culturally competent palliative care, and I'm just wondering if there are any factors that nurses need to be aware of in terms of in end-of-life care. So for example, it might be around gender, it might be around race. I think I saw spirituality in one of the rule of thumb kind of slides. So other factors that maybe are the factors we all need to be aware of all of the time, but in the relevance to end-of-life care.
Absolutely, Nick. And I think, yes, thank you for picking up the point around culturally competent dementia palliative care. A huge issue at the moment. There's been lots of press coverage around the rapidly increasing number of Asian people living with dementia and the inadequacies at the moment of dementia care. And then, of course, projecting that forward, the inadequacies of palliative dementia care for people from ethnic minority groups. So in terms of what should nurses be doing, they should absolutely be using a person-centered approach, asking, understanding what is culturally important for that person and that family, understanding that and being respectful. So being curious, asking questions, and if they're not sure, for example, using faith leaders within their respective NHS organisations to support them in their practice. But absolutely vital, particularly for people living at home, that we're always a guest in their home. So being very respectful of what is culturally appropriate for them. And of course, particularly at the end of life, that cultures will have different requirements that are very, very important for them in the dying phase and also after death.
Thank you for that. Any other panellists want to pick up on that?
I think the only other thing I'd quite like to add is to emphasise exactly what Catherine has said, but not to let that constrain your caring ability. I think sometimes we see nurses and other healthcare professionals so anxious to be doing the right thing that it actually constrains their capacity to care. And I think as long as you are person-centred, as Catherine said, and demonstrating your willingness to care, people will forgive your lack of knowledge, as long as that is just a lack of knowledge and not a lack of empathy or understanding.
Okay, thanks for that. One thing this is kind of I'm jumping a little bit here, but I was quite interested in the rule of thumb as a kind of should I say prescriptive approach to assessment. And I was wondering if the intention is that the rule of thumb would become second nature and it would be something that it reminds me to some extent of the novice to expert type of space.
Yes, absolutely, Nick. And certainly when we were working with our clinical colleagues last week, they were trying out the prototype of our embed care framework and the app. And that is exactly what they were describing, that in using IPOSDEM in clinical practice, they did feel quite a novice, but very much the expectation that they would move through to being expert in it, because they were all very much senior nurses. And I think the rule of thumb, for some, it will be an aid memoir as to what do I need to think about when I'm assessing. For the novice, it will very much be helping them to inform their practice and confirm their learning and understanding, and also give them permission in terms of, for example, care and treatment that they might offer.
Thank you. And thanks to the attendees who are posing questions on the questions and the answers that are coming through. We'll circle back to those if we have time. Thanks also. This is a question in a script that I can't understand. And we'll ask the technical team to see whether they can do a quick Google Translate on that and provide the question to me. Thank you. Thanks very much, Catherine. I wanted to turn to Sue and Natasha now. And I was quite interested in, in my interpretation of this, the presentation, there was a positive feedback about clinical nurse specialists, which I'm not surprised about one bit. But I just wondered what are the reasons that people, so you mentioned some structural problems, like access to records, for example, access to prescribing systems. But I was just wondering if there's a cultural issue here and whether there's a cultural factor and so the people very heavily leaning towards GPs to gain access to medicines. And I can understand that that's perhaps the most lubricated route that people have at the moment. But actually, given that there are many clinical nurse specialists and community nurses also that do have access to those systems, so is there something cultural going on?
Possibly. I think it's probably multifactorial. We collected some data in the survey and also in our case study sites, which suggested that awareness of each other's services, including awareness of nurses as prescribers, ability to prescribe directly to patients, their ability to offer out-of-hours services and prescribe during those services, that was pretty patchy across different professional groups. So there's an issue there about awareness of each other's services, I think. Even some of the community nurses we interviewed weren't really sure that they were able to go on and undertake a V300 qualification. I hope it's changing now as we move to less reliance on GP as provider of sole provider of the primary care. But I think there was an awareness issue, possibly a confidence issue in prescribing too. But as I say, unless there's equity across professional groups in terms of access to systems, it's always going to disadvantage nurses, I think. So I think it is an issue of equity as well. I don't know if you want to add anything, Natasha.
No, I think you have raised some good points there. I think if you look at the evidence around the distribution of specialist palliative care in this country, there are discrepancies if we look across the UK in terms of where that provision is and who is able to access it as a whole, as a more general point, which also obviously affected our study as well.
Mm. Thank you for that. I've just wondered whether Mark might want to come in and talk about this in terms of perhaps a cultural issue with people, the resource being there, the willingness being there, but a block kind of from accessing the expertise that we know exists within nursing.
Yeah, thanks, Nick. I mean, colleagues have brilliantly described through their research some of the, what I would say, kind of inconsistencies around service provision, commissioning, but also I think more detailed than this is both access to expertise, of which nursing, of course, alongside other professionals, delivers. But there is something around the unique contribution of the paradigm of nursing brings to the management of the complexity, both in terms of physical care, spiritual care, and organisation of care in the end of life and a palliative environment. And of course, one of the approaches that have been taken in the past is obviously through commissioning specification to support expansion of different service models. It's always been a very easy place to recruit by nursing. It's often seen as a really attractive specialty to recruit into. I would say that that's probably waned in the last 3 or 4 years. I've seen certainly emerging questions from those who run services actually that recruiting into specialist nurses, post particularly in cancer, end of life and palliative care, has become more challenging. So I think there is something about two things for me, which is one, how do we better describe professionally the specialism of end of life and palliative care, particularly to recruit those early on in their career, as this being a phenomenal opportunity to deliver nursing care. And there's also something we're working on within HEE, which is actually how do we structure a career framework post-qualification to support the different routes and support both evidence and expert. And I think colleagues have talked around the kind of novice to expert pathway, because for me, there are huge opportunities through specialist nursing, obviously right up through to consultant nurses working in palliative care and end of life services. So I think there's a number of areas we need to focus on, which is kind of service specification and design. I think there's a professional approach we need to take to this in terms of understanding how do we better elevate the status of end-of-life palliative care nursing. And then there's the more structural stuff, which is around training and education and access opportunities. Some of these things for me are fundamental to ensure that we get downstream those access issues and opportunities to get people with the expertise to those families and patients who need it.
Thank you. Thanks for that. Anybody want to add on to that? I'll go back, Sue. And Natasha, there's another question that came through about the study. You may not be able to answer this, but I'd appreciate your opinion anyway, in terms of variability for different patient groups in terms of their ability to access end-of-life medicines.
We didn't look at the experience by different professional different patient groups. It was quite difficult to recruit anyway. We tried to ensure that a range of diagnoses were included in our case study sites, but no, we didn't look at that aspect. All that important though it is.
Yeah, and you got no hunch from the findings.
I mean, by definition, they were patients living at home, and therefore that would exclude some patients with more complex needs necessarily. We tended to recruit patients who did have support from a carer, so we didn't necessarily study in depth the experience of people who would be living alone, which again is another important area that warrants research, I think. It's difficult to say on the basis of hunch, I think, sorry, but...
No, it's unfair to ask you because the study, you never set out to answer those questions.
No.
But I just saw whether, incidentally, there might be some findings that came through that sometimes studies do reveal things you weren't expecting. But no, I apologise for putting you on the spot there.
I think our findings were illustrative of the way that some specialist services are set up. So in the CNS prescriber case, for example, there were more patients. Cancer diagnoses for the patients in that particular case, and then in the telephone support line, because every patient in the area was referred on entry to the GSF as much wider breadth of diagnoses for that patient in that particular case.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for that. There was one question you may be able to answer quite quickly. Is there plans to revisit the study? One of our attendees mentioned paramedics and paramedic science as thinking about paramedic prescribers and thinking about whether another study could include other professionals also and not just clinical nurse specialists and community nurses.
That's a question for Natasha.
Thank you. Yes, we have been successfully awarded a Marie Curie grant to look at the contribution provided by paramedics in this area. So that will be a follow-on study. But its genesis was within ACTMED.
That's fantastic. And I assure you that wasn't a planted question, as far as I'm aware.
Really, really important role, very understudied. And we're looking forward to getting to grips with the detail of how paramedics contribute and what their needs might be to contribute more in this area.
Thank you. I'll turn now to Catherine Walsh. You mentioned in your presentation the need for nurses to manage complexity around end-of-life care, to manage relationships, to manage organisational culture or organisational barriers. And I wonder if you had any advice on how nurses in practice might go about this. This sounds like a job and a half just to manage the complexity around it all.
I think my main comment on that is actually being aware of your own biases. Life is complex, care is complex, and we spend a lot of time attending to that complexity. I think sometimes we spend less time attending to ourselves and our own biases. Because I think when I presented some of those findings to the staff concerned, they were really quite surprised that so much of the patterns of care were formed by the decisions that they'd made about, and I'm being very open here, whether they liked the other person that they were referring to or not, whether they got on, whether they could trust them with their patients. So I think we need to be very aware that we carry with us a lot of baggage, whether that be cultural baggage, whether that be baggage about previous past relationships or experiences that we've had had with other patients that affect the care that we give going on. So I agree, Nick, it's very challenging. You can't be all things to all people. You have to attend to what you're doing at that point in time and do it to the best of your knowledge. And hopefully, as we've been talking about today, based on the best possible evidence that's available to you to make those decisions. But I think being very reflective about what is influencing those decisions is actually critically important.
Thank you. And I will throw this open to the panel, because actually each of the studies that were discussed through all of the presentations did have elements of decision-making, complexity, relationships, organisational culture, etc. And just so, can I just go in turn? Can I go to you, Catherine Evans? Sorry, to you, surnames as well.
So particularly around the clinical decision-making, Nick, is that what you'd like us to...
Yeah, if that it's managing these very problematic areas, you know, complexity around whether it's about relationships, decision making, organisational culture, perhaps going beyond use our rule of thumb approach.
Absolutely. So I think. So I'm just thinking about palliative dementia care. I mean, an incredibly complex area of clinical practice, not least because of the huge level of clinical uncertainty as to the individual's illness trajectory. So things like prognostication is very uncertain and probably on the whole unhelpful, and probably one of the main barriers as to why people living with dementia often don't receive palliative care, don't receive end-of-life care until they're in the dying phase. So for us on the Embed Care programme, we move very much away from that in wanting it to be a needs-based approach, that the provision of palliative care was based upon need. And that very much then informed why we then included an approach to enhance a holistic assessment by using a validated outcome measure as part of routine clinical care to identify those unstable and unmet needs. And also importantly, being able to evaluate, well, what difference did the clinical care that was delivered, did it actually address those unmet needs? And being able to demonstrate the difference, for example, that community nursing can make, understand better the symptoms and concerns that people are presenting with, and how provision of community nursing can make a huge difference to people's lives.
Thank you. Sue and Natasha, any tips?
I think in relation to medicines in particular, the data from the survey suggested that actually clinical nurse specialists in particular feel pretty competent at prescribing palliative care medicines. That was mixed across the other professional groups, in particular in pharmacists, less competence there. I think the key issue in terms of complexity that we brought to the fore was the issue of coordination is huge, complex, hard work, time consuming. I mean, coordination of services has always been a part of a nurse's role, we know that, but it's to what extent is coordination burdensome because of the deficiency of other services, really. And we argued in our report that actually coordination is important, but it needs to be within a context that is supportive of accessing medicine. So we need reliable community pharmacy stock. We need better electronic communication and shared access to records. So I think it is always going to be complex, but could be supported better by the context.
Thank you, Natasha.
We'll just add in that through the study, we showed how important it was to look at decision making from the patients and their families as well. It was incredibly difficult for lots of patients and their families to make appropriate decisions because they hadn't been showed the way on how to navigate those systems, and perhaps some simple things around sitting down with a patient and talking through how you go about accessing medicines and in what circumstances and who it's best to go to are really key to patient experience.
Thank you. Mark, I'm going to bring you in here again. I think nurses, what we've heard reinforces what we've heard previously about nurses being informational knowledge brokers, being coordinators of care, and just thinking perhaps from thinking about the educational side of things and HEE side of things, thinking about what, how we might prepare nurses for increasingly complex roles in increasingly complex environments.
Yeah, thanks, Nick. I mean, colleagues have through the research have really described some really interesting issues, which is particularly around that boundary interface between the physical coordination, because the system is not geared up to support people through a complex pathway, versus the knowledge required to actually care navigate somebody and the paradigm of nursing. And I'll be honest, I'm sat on a fence a bit here, because actually there is no hard line between that for me. Actually, it's very blended, because actually the expertise that nurses gather over a period of clinical exposure and time within a specialty allow, I consider that navigation actual decision making, because no matter what system I've studied or looked at, and I'll be honest, I'm not an end of life specialist, but I have done research into surgical emergency and other pathways where clinical decision is made. Actually, that aggregation of knowledge around the decision points, decision making, is fundamentally a nursing knowledge expertise, a part of the same paradigm and domain. So there is something for me about recognizing that some of this work, some of this experience that nurses require is really important. But I do think that then does become a hard edge where actually nurses are essentially navigating people because the system is not working effectively. So we've got to kind of get that boundary right. And to be honest, I think that's up to us as an academic community to study and understand that and describe it. Because actually for me, that then therefore underpins and formulates how we prepare people within practice through various programmes. And I think, again, colleagues have brilliantly described this kind of novice through expert. You know, I still find really complex decisions being made by the nomenclature novice nurses working in end of life practice. One of the questions for me is around how do we develop that knowledge base and foundations within core undergraduate professional practice. I think there's a greater emphasis we need to apply around decision making, critical thinking capability, and the use of evidence, and also importantly a greater exposure to end of life, because they are ubiquitous across the pathway, of irrespective of whether it's a specific end of life pathway or not. And then of course, as I've talked about, this kind of structural approach to career development and through into masters, particularly advanced level practice, open brackets, end of life palliative care specialization, which includes other areas. And I broadly think of it's not just about medicines management. Whilst that's really, really important, I broaden that out about the therapeutic intervention that a specialist nurse in this environment could make. And that might be spiritual intervention, it might be a psychological intervention, it might be a medications intervention. Each of those requires a lot of expertise to deliver. So I think we should think about, you know, therapeutic delivery in a much broader sense, and therefore the preparation of the programs that go into that. But either way, I think there's a little bit more study for us to do to understand those domains of practice, and therefore understand what can therefore be taught into programs. So yeah, I think there's a lot to do, and further research, as you'd expect from an academic to say, further research is required. But I think we know quite a lot at the moment to think about how do we prepare those in undergraduate versus those in more higher level roles.
Thank you for that. And I will talk about further research actually in a second. You mentioned about complexity and decision making. There are now whole meetings, whole conferences around artificial intelligence, which is absolutely can resolve some of that complexity, but it seems so far removed from what we're talking about now. I think it's very interesting to see, you know, it'll be interesting to see how that pans out. I wanted to, we're coming close to time now. I did want to, one of the questions was a general question for all of the panelists actually, which is about emerging areas of research or exciting areas of research that are kind of around the corner in end-of-life care, and particularly in the context of nursing. And I wonder if we could just share some of your own thoughts and dreams, visions of what we might be doing in 5 or 10 years' time, perhaps, or next week. Let's go in the order that we have the presentation. So Catherine Walsh first, please.
I mean, I think we need to take much more account of dying that is everybody's business. You know, we know a third of people in hospital at any one time will die within a year. You know, we know that many of these people with complex comorbid conditions, including, you know, the people with dementia that Catherine is working with, are close to death, and we don't recognise that. So I think the research agenda really needs to focus on general palliative care that we are all able to deliver, so that we are educated and prepared to deliver that well. But we also need to recognise that we work within a complex system, and our research needs to address that complex system: healthcare, social care, community-based care. And by that, I don't mean me as a district nurse. I mean the community, our compassionate communities, lay people, lay navigators, volunteers, part of a complex system of care to enable people to die as well as possible in the place of their choice. So I think it's that general palliative care that we need to pay attention to, bearing in mind the changes that much of our historic research was focused on cancer in, you know, if we look a decade or two decades ago now. That's not the case now. It is people with frailty, with dementia, with complex comorbid conditions, where I think nursing and nursing research has much to offer.
Thank you. Sue?
Yeah, I'd second that. When we look at the tidal wave of demand that's going to be coming down the line for palliative care, particularly in the community, we need to pay attention to, I think, how we all are prepared for that across the workforce, rather than thinking about leaving it to specialists. In relation to medicines in particular, I think there's a package of work to be done around deprescribing too, and how we manage that, both in terms of medicines waste and how we help patients prioritise the medicines that they want to take in the last 12 months of life. And my hobby horse that has been with me all my career really is how actually we prepare people with information, knowledge and skills to help them self-manage their medicines. I still think there's work to be done there about how best we individualise that and how we work in partnership with patients and carers to meet their own individual needs on that.
Thank you. Anything to add, Natasha?
No, I totally endorse the point that's already been made about this need to upskill the generalist workforce, as you picked up in one of your points that you made earlier, that there is an issue in terms of specialist palliative care in this country. The workforce is ageing, and actually the majority of patients with palliative and end-of-life care needs see generalists as opposed to specialists.
Thank you, Catherine.
Thank you. I'd agree with all those points. I think maybe the sort of exciting areas moving forward is probably the digital age. I sort of think, I said on Embed Care, we'd planned for an app, but we were future-proofing when we wrote that grant. And of course, during COVID, the future has very much arrived. And I think now in capitalising on that digital innovation that has happened over the last 2 years, but capitalising it on a way that doesn't, you know, that ensures equitable provision of healthcare and doesn't drive further the inequities that we saw during COVID. And I think particularly around enabling family carers and home carers, social care staff, to be using that sort of digital technology, for example, to be able to report symptoms and concerns and access resources, so that they are, if you like, more health literate in being able to be more of an active participant in their care, and to be able to work much more in partnership with the healthcare practitioners. So I think that's an exciting area that we certainly have seen huge growth and continuing to see growth, but we need to use it well and smartly to actually make a difference for patients and families in the community.
Thank you. And Mark, just a very brief final word from you.
Just a thank you. Thank you to everybody for sharing your research and your brilliant support and ideas around this area of work. I mean, it's been a great session this afternoon, and I hope the colleagues who have joined us today have learned a great deal. I certainly have, but it's also sparked a lot of interest for me around other opportunities for further work and links through into how we support nursing for the future.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Thanks to all of our speakers for the presentations and for sharing your insights. Thank you also to Mark for joining us today. And thanks to the teams for setting the webinar up. You'll find a link to in the chat to an evaluation, a short evaluation. It'll help us in terms of future planning. The reason that we have this webinar and the topic of this webinar is because of the feedback that we received. So please do contribute to that. Just spend a couple of minutes doing that. And we do want these webinars to be as good as they can be. I hope you found the event interesting, informative, got your juices flowing in terms of research. And I hope you leave the event with a sense of pride in our wonderful profession and curiosity to get more involved in research. So on behalf of the School of Human and Health Sciences at the University of Huddersfield and on behalf of NHS England, I'd like to thank you for coming along today. And I hope to see you again at the next webinars. Take care. Thank you for coming along and good afternoon.